When most people go to buy a new phone, they aren't looking to drop a grand on the top-level flagship out there. They want something a little more affordable, a little more practical. The good news is that mid-range phones are better than they have ever been. I'm going to run through five of my favorite mid-range phones you can buy right now. This is in July 2021 that I'm recording this. I'm going to be updating this in about 6 months or so. So if it's been a while since July 2021, check back to see if there's a later version. There's one other quick caveat I want to get out of the way before I get straight into my list. I'm based in the UK, if you can't tell from my voice. I'm going to be talking through phones that are available in the UK and in a lot of the world. Not all of these are available in North America, though. There are two phones in this list that you can buy if you're in the US. I'm going to just spoil it straight away and say they are the Asus Zenfone 8 and Google's Pixel 4a. But the rest of the phones on this list are available in Europe and a lot of Asia, but you won't be able to find them if you're in the States. I'm sorry. So without further ado, here are my five favorite mid-range phones for mid-2021. So the first phone I want to talk about is also the cheapest in this list. It's Xiaomi's Redmi Note 10 Pro. And it starts from just £249 or $279. That is a dollar price. I did just say it's not available in the States. It's not officially out in the States despite that price, though actually if you look on Amazon, you might find an import model for around $279, give or take. This may be the cheapest of these mid-range phones, but don't hold that against it. It is seriously, seriously impressive. It's big for one thing, so if you want a big screen, this might be the phone for you. It's got a 6.67 inch AMOLED display with a 120 hertz refresh rate. That's the kind of feature that some flagship phones still don't have, but it's worked its way down to this really, really affordable device. It's powered by the Snapdragon 732G. That's a mid-range chip, but it's a pretty decent one. But there is one big caveat. It doesn't support 5G. 5G is kind of working its way into the mid-range market. A lot of mid-range phones have it, but still a few don't. This is one of the holdouts that has no 5G support. But one of the benefits of that is that Xiaomi has had the budget to then add a little oomph to some of the other specs to make up for it. The big one is the camera, and that's really what this phone is about. That's because the main sensor here is a 108 megapixel sensor. That means you're getting amazing amounts of detail packed into every shot. And it's also a pretty large sensor, so it's capable of taking in a lot of light, which makes it great in low light as well. The one downside to the camera is there's no optical image stabilization, or OIS. That's pretty typical for the mid-range market, to be honest, but it does mean if you're looking at that kind of camera spec and thinking, wow, it's really similar to the flagship Xiaomi Mi 11, it is different. It's a different sensor and without the stabilization as well, it means it doesn't hold up quite as well for low light and certainly not as well for video. But still, this is a really capable camera. Because the phone is big, there's also space to pack in a big battery, 5,020 milliamp hours to be precise, which means you're getting great battery life, and there's also decent charging speeds too. To be honest, the only thing I don't love about the Redmi Note 10 Pro is the software. They run Xiaomi's MIUI Android skin, and it's decent, but there is much better Android software out there, especially to sort of European and American software palettes. MIUI to me feels clunky and busy and awkward to navigate. And so that's the only con I'd really hold up against this phone. But otherwise, the amount of spec you're getting for the price is very hard to beat. If the Redmi Note 10 Pro is the cheapest phone I'm going to talk about today, the Realme GT might be the best value. It definitely costs more than the Note 10 Pro, but wow, you are getting a lot for the price. This is a Snapdragon 888 powered phone. That is, at the moment, the most powerful chip on the market that's actually in a phone. They've announced an 888 Plus, but as I'm recording this, we haven't seen that turn up in any devices yet. But that is a flagship chip. It's the chip you find in phones two, even three times this price. And here, they haven't even skimped on the other specs. It's paired with LPDDR5 RAM and UFS 3.1 storage. Again, from a core specs perspective, this is top tier. You're not really going to get better performance than this in a phone, despite that amazing price. And of course, flagship chip also means it's got 5G, unlike the Redmi. Battery is also impressive. You're getting 65 watt charging, really impressive battery life. The display is a 120 hertz AMOLED again. So it's a really top tier screen. The camera is really the only bit that doesn't feel flagship, flagship, flagship. It's a 64 megapixel main lens paired with an ultra wide and then just a little macro sensor. It's fine. It's a decent camera. It's okay if you want to point and shoot, but it's definitely not the best out there. And that's clearly where Realme's saved most of the money. The other flagship features you're not getting are wireless charging. In fact, none of the phones I'm talking about today have wireless charging, and a waterproof rating. Some of the phones I'm going to talk about do have it, but the Realme GT doesn't. And again, that's that little giveaway. This isn't truly a flagship, even though it often looks and feels like one. And speaking of looks, this might be my favorite looking phone I'm going to talk about in today's video. There are three colors available. There's a kind of boring black and blue glass models, but the best has got to be the vegan leather yellow option with this black glass racing stripe running down below the camera lens. It looks like it's pulled straight out of Kill Bill or Bumblebee from Transformers or something like that. It looks fantastic. It's really striking. I'm normally not a huge fan of leather finished phones, but honestly, this one works for me. It's very eye-catching and in the best possible way. Realme has knocked it out of the park with the GT. If the Realme GT delivers flagship specs at a mid-range price, the Asus Zenfone 8 is just straight up a flagship. Like, this is actually a flagship phone. It's not really a mid-range, but it's a flagship that's priced so affordably that it definitely sneaks into what we consider a mid-range device based on price alone. Just getting a Snapdragon 888, just like on the Realme GT, and you're getting that top-tier RAM and the fast storage as well. Unlike the Realme GT, you're also getting features like Gorilla Glass Victus to protect the display. That's the strongest, toughest Gorilla Glass around. And very importantly, an IP68 waterproof rating. Again, pretty much the best around. Though, as I already said before, there is no wireless charging. So that is still the one kind of big flagship omission that you're not going to find in a phone at this kind of price. Like on the Realme GT, I think the camera is again the compromise here. You're just getting two lenses, a main lens and an ultrawide. And again, they are competent, they are fine, they will do the job. But this is not going to compete with the top level iPhone 12s or the Samsung S21s or the Sony Xperias in terms of that amazing camera experience you're looking for. So if that's your priority, there are better phones on this list for you. Instead, the really big draw, I think, with the Zenfone 8 is just the size. The screen is only 5.9 inches, which may sound like a big display depending on what your expectations are and your reference points, but for 2021, 5.9 inches is a very compact phone display. And the phone only weighs 169 grams too, so it's light as well. That basically means this is a small, compact, portable Android phone that still delivers the kind of specs you'd normally find in much larger devices. That's clearly going to be a big draw for a lot of people. The Asus Zenfone 8 is small, but Google's Pixel 4a is even smaller. Instead of a 5.9 inch screen, here you're getting a 5.81 inch screen, and it weighs below 150 grams. This might be the smallest modern Android phone you can buy. So if compact is what you're looking for, Google actually still has Asus pipped there. There are downsides. You're getting a slower processor. You're getting a 730G rather than the 888. You're not getting the same RAM and storage speeds. The other drawback is that the Pixel 4a only supports 4G. This is yet another phone on this list that does not support 5G connection speeds. If that matters to you, there is also the Pixel 4a 5G, which you guessed it, does 5G. But that's actually quite a different phone. It's bigger, it's got some different specs, there's some different camera stuff going on. So do give the Pixel 4a 5G, but actually in terms of mid-range pricing and value for money, I would still rate the regular 4a over it. There are other compromises here compared to some of the other phones on this list. You're getting a much smaller battery than some of the other devices I'm talking about today. Only 18 watt wired charging speeds, which I'm pretty sure is the slowest of all the phones I'm talking about. It's also the only phone here that is capped at 60 hertz refresh rate rather than 90 or 120. So these are all drawbacks. They're partly due to the age of the 4a. It's almost a year old at the point I'm recording this, but also just down to the way Google builds its devices. There are other advantages though. For one, you're getting Google's Pixel OS software. This is, for a lot of people, the best version of Android out there. Comes with other perks though, because it also means because you're getting your software straight from Google, you're going to get much faster updates and guaranteed updates to the latest Android versions as they come out, and some Pixel exclusive features that other Android phones just never get. You are, of course, also getting that Pixel camera. And I know the 4a is only a mid-range device, but honestly, the camera experience is so close still to what Google puts into its top tier flagship phones. That is definitely worth looking at. And although the camera specs on paper might seem worse here than some of the other phones I'm talking about, this is still arguably the best camera you're gonna find from any of these phones. It also has the perk that, like the Zenfone 8, you can buy this phone if you're in the US or Canada, so your list is much shorter there. But the Pixel 4a definitely beats the Zenfone 8 on the camera if that's what you're picking between. And I did say that the Pixel 4a is getting a little long in the tooth, it's just about a year old. That's for good reason I'm still recommending it though, because while there is a Pixel 5a 5G on the way, Google has already warned that that phone is going to be limited to the US and Japan. So unless that changes, for most people around the world, the 4a is going to remain, for a while, the best mid-range Pixel phone you can get. All right, moving quickly from the oldest phone I'm talking about today to the most recent, we have the OnePlus Nord 2, which, as I recall this, has pretty much only just been announced by OnePlus. Last year's original Nord was my absolute favorite mid-range phone of all of 2020, and I have high hopes that the Nord 2 is going to do the same for 2021. You're getting some of the best specs from last year's phone carried over, very similar 6.43-inch 90Hz AMOLED display, just 90, not 120, but still, that's very solid. I think that's the most important jump. The gap between 90 and 120 is hard to spot, even for me, if I'm being honest. This is also the only phone in today's video that has a MediaTek chipset rather than one of the Qualcomm Snapdragon chips. However, what it's got is MediaTek's Dimensity 1200 AI. That's MediaTek's flagship chip, the Dimensity 1200, but it's also a customized version built together with OnePlus that really amps up some of the AI and machine learning features to draw out the best of the phone. Because it's a OnePlus phone, you're getting some of the typical OnePlus perks. There's 65-watt fast charging, which is seriously, seriously nippy. And you're getting Oxygen OS. I said before that Google's Pixel software is arguably the best Android version around. Well, if anything's going to beat it, it's OnePlus's Oxygen OS. And yes, I know there's a lot of uncertainty right now around the merging Oxygen with Oppo's ColorOS as those companies come closer together, but still, Oxygen is really, really, really lovely. Don't hold that against it. OnePlus has even improved its update promise, so you should get 2 years worth of Android version updates from the Nord 2. And finally, it's also fixing one of OnePlus's classic weaknesses, which is the camera. And they've been really working hard at this in their recent flagships. It was a big emphasis of the 9 series, and they tried to carry some of that down to the Nord 2. The main lens here is a 50 megapixel camera using a Sony IMX766 sensor. That is the same sensor that they used for the wide angle in the 9 and the 9 Pro, and it's also the same sensor that Oppo used for both its main and wide angle lenses in the Oppo Find X3 Pro, probably my favorite flagship phone right now, and with an amazing camera. Even better, they managed to pack in OIS, which, as I said, was one of the big drawbacks of the Redmi Note 10 Pro, that it didn't make the most of that big 108 megapixel sensor because it lacked OIS. Well, the OnePlus Nord 2 fits that in, which means you're getting much, much better low light performance. OnePlus is actually so confident in that they've used this to roll out a new mode they're calling Nightscape Ultra. The Nord 2 is so recent that I'm still not sure if it's my favorite mid-range phone of this year, like the Nord 1 was last year, but it's very, very close. So there you have it. Those are my favorite 5 mid-range phones that you can buy right now in mid-2021. I've got to admit, I was nearly tearing my hair out trying to pick these 5 phones. There are so many mid-range devices on the market right now. It was incredibly hard to narrow it down to just 5. So I have no doubt that if you are watching this, you think I have omitted something brilliant that should have been in this list, or I've included something that I'm an absolute idiot for putting in. So please do jump down into the comments. Let me know what phones you think should be in here. Give your recommendations to anyone else watching the video. And of course, please remember to like and subscribe, and stay tuned to Tech Advisor for more.